Good morning, Union Church, and all who have joined us through the gift of technology. It is so good to be with you once again here in the house of praise and worship together, though we may be apart, on this fifth Sunday of the season of Lent, and also an affirmation Sunday. We'll be affirming our faith with one another in reciting the Apostles' Creed today. And as always, in these changing times, we continue to trust in the bedrock assurances of our scriptures. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change. Now let us focus hearts and minds on the worship of our God and hear the call to worship. Today, from Psalm 119, "Blessed are you, O Lord, teach me your statutes. With my whole heart I seek you. Do not let me stray from your commandments. I treasure your word in my heart so that I may not sin against you. With my lips I declare all the ordinances of your mouth. I delight in the way of your decrees as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes and will not forget your word." Let us worship God. Let us begin by hearing our prayer of invocation to invite the Holy Spirit into our midst, followed by our hymn of praise.
From his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love.
beloved of God, let's take a moment in our worship to go to our God in confession together. Our scriptures assure us, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us then come before our gracious Lord to confess our sin, praying together. Holy and most merciful God, as we continue our journey through this Lenten season of repentance and renewal, we come now before you humbly to confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, that we have not loved you with all our heart, soul, and strength, nor loved our neighbor as ourselves. God of grace, we ask you to forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and by your mercy guide what we shall be, so that we may walk in the way of your will and do those things which are pleasing in your sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And let's take a moment of silent confession together. And all God's people said together, Amen. Friends, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Let us then proclaim the good news of the gospel, and I hope you'll say it right where you are. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Having received such great peace from our Lord and our redemption, it is right for us to pass that peace of Christ to one another. And so I say to you, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. I hope you'll pass that peace if there are others worshiping with you. It's announcement time in our service, and just a few this morning. The season of Lent will be drawing to a close soon as we enter the final week of Lent, which is Holy Week, beginning next Sunday, March 28th, with our observance of Palm Sunday. And as in years past, the palm branches commemorating Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem will be displayed in our virtual worship space. Then on Thursday, April 1st, we will continue our tradition here at Union Church of the solemn observance of Maundy Thursday, commemorating the Last Supper. We will celebrate virtual communion together and conclude the service with a short candlelight tenebrae service, entering into the shadows of Good Friday as we hear the seven last words of Christ. And then, after 3 days, there will be light and joy and abundant life as we virtually celebrate the resurrection of the Lord on Easter Sunday, April 4th. We're making a departure this year from Easter lilies and will fill our virtual worship space with color, with a variety of spring flowers. Because it is the first Sunday of the month, we will also virtually celebrate the Lord's Supper as well. And following the service, we will hold a Zoom coffee hour at 12:15 p.m. It's Easter, so let's get together. It's been so long, excepting that little short period of Advent where we worshiped in person and then had to once again suspend. And so it will be good to see each other. And I really would like to try in the near future to do regular Zoom coffee hours, hopefully weekly. But if you would like to be at that Zoom coffee hour, make sure that you call the office to talk to Nishani or call me, and make sure we have your email address so we can send the Zoom meeting invite to you. As always, folks, remember, I'm here for you as your pastor. I'm glad to meet you here at the church. We can do that observing the precautions and wearing masks, to pray or just talk if you'd like, or feel free to call on me anytime. Just know I'm available to you. Now, let's continue in worship by turning to the proclamation of God's holy word, and let us hear our prayer of illumination.
To my path, thy word.
Testament lesson for today comes to us from the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 31, beginning at the 31st verse. Listen for the word of God. "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, 'Know the Lord,' for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A way as gives us breath, such a truth as ends all strife, such a life as killeth death. Come, my light, my feast, my strength, such a light as shows a feast, such a feast as mends in length, such a strength as makes his guest. Come, my joy, as joy in love.
Amen. Our New Testament lesson today comes to us from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 to 36. Listen for the word of God. "Now among those who went up to worship at the festival, Passover, were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, 'Sir, we wish to see Jesus.' And Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, 'The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? 'Father, save me from this hour?' No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. 'Father, glorify your name.' And then a voice came from heaven, 'I have glorified it and I will glorify it again.' The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, 'An angel has spoken to him.' And Jesus answered, 'This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself.' He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The crowd answered him, 'We have heard from the law that the Messiah remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?' And Jesus said to them, "The light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become children of light." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I'd like to speak to you this morning for a few moments on this thought: drawing all people. Pray with me, if you will. Holy One, be with the words of my mouth. Give any words that are needed. Move me aside that the people may see you, God. And be with the meditation of all of our hearts, that you may receive honor and glory, and we receive blessing by the proclamation of your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Drawing all people. I would guess that most of our church members at some point have considered the question, what drew me to Union Church? Or if you're a member at another church and you're worshiping with us virtually, whatever your church might be. Maybe it was for a survey as part of a congregational mission study to prepare for calling a new pastor. Maybe it was part of a discussion in a Bible study, whatever. What drew you to your church? Well, you might say, the people were friendly. The pastor preached pretty good sermons. Boy, that choir was really good. They were doing a lot of hands-on mission work at that church, and so on. Those are the very common responses to what drew somebody to a congregation. And now, this is on my mind today because of something Jesus says in our passage from the Gospel of John as he predicts his own death and resurrection and says, "I will draw all people to myself." And one begins to realize whatever drew us to our particular church, it wouldn't have happened. It couldn't have happened without Jesus Christ behind it, in the music, in the preaching, in the friendly dispositions. Now, there's a lot going on in this scripture passage, really. The passage is somewhat of a parallel to passages that we see in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, where Jesus shares the surprising and disturbing news that he is destined to die, to be put to death on a cross at that. And he speaks of the need for his followers to be willing to lose their lives in order to gain their lives, and to bear their cross every day if they follow him. But we touched on that a few weeks ago, so I kept coming back to this idea with our John passage of Jesus drawing all people to himself. As with most of the gospel story, John's gospel recalls this story from Jesus' life in chapter 12 and what he teaches with a much more developed theology, and with more layers of meaning than you tend to find in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So rather than simply talking about our need to bear our cross every day, as the other Gospels do, in John, Jesus teaches that losing our lives and following him has to do with serving him, rejecting the ruler of this world, or Satan, and walking in the light that earlier in chapter 9 he proclaimed that he was for the world. And he speaks almost philosophically of his own death in saying, "I will draw all people to myself when I am lifted up from the earth." It's not exactly clear what he means by lifted up. You could interpret that as his being hung up on the cross, or his resurrection, rising from the dead, or his ascension back into heaven, in his glorification as a member of the triune God, the Son of God. Most likely, John wants us to think of all three, because that's just how it is with John's gospel. As straightforward as it can be to read, there's always a lot more going on. But the bottom line of what Jesus is saying is that his saving act of redemption and atonement through his death and resurrection will draw all people to him. Indeed, it's interesting how this passage begins with Greeks, or Gentiles, approaching the disciples because they wish to see Jesus. Something has drawn them to him. Now, our story today comes on the heels of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which we'll talk more about next Sunday on Palm Sunday. But we're told by John that this great crowd in Jerusalem, up there for the Passover, presumably including many Gentile God-fearers, non-Jews who worshiped the God of Israel, heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, which causes this great stir of his triumphal entry. Now think back a few weeks and recall when we last heard about Gentile God-fearers, or what John calls Greeks. It was back when I preached on Jesus' cleansing of the temple a few weeks ago. And if you remember, the area of the temple where Jesus engaged in this violent protest, really, was the area where Gentiles were allowed to pray and worship. Indeed, we believe part of Jesus' outrage was at how the animal sellers and money changers had crowded the space where Gentiles were invited into the temple. And this is a bit of conjecture on my part. The scripture doesn't explicitly say this, but what if the word had got out that amongst the Gentiles and Greeks, Jesus was that Jewish rabbi who stood up for us Gentile God-fearers that one time in the temple, and he protested on our behalf. And now he's back in Jerusalem. We want to meet him, right? Jesus' demonstration of concern for them, caring for their cause, their lives, and advocacy for them is what's drawing people to him. And others in the crowd on the way into Jerusalem, John tells us, had been there when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, when he showed the crowd that he can restore life and give new life, right? Jesus' deeds are drawing all people to him. Indeed, the concern that Jesus shows for the other, the willingness to stand with, stand up for, to serve, to meet the needs of, that is to say, to show God's concern and welcome and God's love, this is what draws people to Jesus. So, those of us who now comprise Jesus' body on earth, we who are the body of Christ, the church, you and me, we are then to serve Jesus and glorify him by showing the world ourselves that he is concerned for their lives and about what matters to them and about their needs and seeks to welcome them. In other words, to show them how much God loves them, that Jesus may draw all people to himself through us. But we who are called the body of Christ to extend this invitation to draw all people to him have to be honest about what we're up against as we strive to witness to the good news of Christ's salvation and God's love and mercy to the world around us in changing times. How well is the church doing in drawing all people to Christ? And we've all been through many conversations through the years on how our society and culture have evolved and changed over recent decades so that the Christian church no longer occupies the same normative role and place of authority in our public life. How at one time in most communities across our country, and even at the national level in terms of holidays and the rhythms of our civic life, the role of the church was always in some way central to that communal life. But over the past 50 years especially, religious pluralism has increased and secularism has increased. That's become our everyday reality. And in so many ways now, it's pushed the church to the margins of our lives. And to put it in plain English in a way that I think we can all easily understand, kids play soccer and baseball and go to ballet on Sunday mornings now. Those organizations and the families who understandably want to take part just don't plan to be here. And that's that. Presbyterian pastor and Fuller Theological Seminary staff, the Reverend Dr. Todd Bolsinger, puts it about as succinctly as anyone I've read recently. And there's been a lot of writing done on this. He writes, "Most churches are dying. We are in uncharted terrain trying to lead those churches into a post-Christian culture that now considers the church an optional, out-of-touch, and irrelevant relic of the past. hard to hear when it's put that way, isn't it, friends? But it's necessary to hear. And honestly, we all already had some sense that that's true. We all have a sense, I think, my brothers and sisters, that what we are doing in many of our churches, in many ways, has run into a basic disconnect with the world around us, with the people who Christ seeks to draw to himself. And it can feel like we're stuck. And Bolsinger goes on to quote renowned organizational expert and rabbi Edwin Friedman. He's passed on now, but in his lifetime worked extensively with religious communities of all kinds and developed what's called systems theory, as analyzing those community systems. And he once wrote himself, when any system, that is a church congregation, for example, is gridlocked, it cannot be unstuck simply by trying harder. Because that's what we tend to do, isn't it, friends? We think that to fix things, we just have to try harder at what we're already doing. And Friedman exhorts us that rather what must happen is first that spirit of adventure, which enables new perceptions beyond the control of our thinking processes, must happen first. In other words, Bolsinger writes, the answer is not to try harder, but to be willing to say to each other, I don't know what to do. And then, together, start a new adventure. And with each other, figure it out. And that's okay to be in that place. Bolsinger adds, this is an opportunity for exploration, transformation of what we are doing. A moment when our congregation can take on new life, start imagining different possibilities, end quote. So we who are Christ's body, who are called to Jesus' mission to draw all people to him, we are at a place where we have a choice. Even now in the midst of this pandemic, but certainly once we are back in person together and can begin to make a sense of where we're at and how to move forward. We can choose to get depressed about it and feel paralyzed, or we can choose to stand on the shoulders and believe in what every generation of Christian believers has had to do for 2,000 years, that God is with us. And God is a mighty fortress and indeed a rock on which we stand. And that what we face, whether the church has 4,000 members or just 40, the time that we're in is a time of possibility for the church and for this church. To believe that we are in the midst of, as Ecclesiastes teaches us, we will face a time to lose, to pluck up what is planted, a time to break down what's come before, that we may enter a time to seek, and a time to plant, and a time to build up. These watershed crossroads in our history, these are places God has brought us to. So we trust that, as Hebrews 13 reminds us, even in times of difficulty, scarcity, uncertainty, God has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. And we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. So whatever it is about church life, about how we do things that may not be drawing all people to Christ, we should be ready, as Jesus challenges us in our passage from John today, to lose that life, that in its dying, it may bear much fruit as we move into the future. The early 20th century pastor and popular New Testament scholar, William Barclay, told the story of a Salvation Army volunteer who retired to a small home in London during World War II. And then the bombings of the city started. And although she was aging and her active days were behind her, she knew she felt called to do something. So she put together a first aid kit to keep in the home, and then hung a sign in the window of the home that read simply, if you need help, knock here. If you need help, knock here. And friends, I would like us to consider how that invitation is exactly what the message of the Church Universal should be, and of any given congregation. I mean, perhaps better than all the sermons we could preach and all the money we could give to mission would be simply to hang a sign on our front door that said, "If you need help, knock here," and be ready to be there to help, to reach out in that way and say, "We care. You're loved just as you are." I mean, brothers and sisters, isn't that why you came here? I mean, forget that. Isn't that why you turned to Jesus Christ and gave him a chance at all? He drew you to him because you knew someone had proclaimed it to you. In some way you heard it, whatever form that took in your life, the gospel was presented to you and you responded because you said, "This God loves me. This Jesus knows me just as I am and wants me to walk with him in abundant life." Right? Nurturing and strengthening and living out the attitude of concern for others, welcome, hospitality, willingness to help, whether or not we actually hang a sign, that should underlie everything that we do here. It should be the foundation of who we are, that others may see what you saw and be drawn in to the abundant life of Jesus Christ. If we can just strive for that, friends, and prayerfully commit ourselves to it throughout this season of Lent as we return to our God and beyond, I believe we'll find that is indeed all it takes to draw all people to Jesus. Amen.
See you.
It is Affirmation Sunday, friends, third Sunday of the month. And so I would ask that right where you are, that you stand if you're able. And let us affirm our faith together this month, reciting the Apostles' Creed. And you'll see it on your screen if you need a little help. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. It's offering time in our service, and we want to encourage you in this virtual format we're worshiping in just to be faithful in your giving. We're so grateful for those who've continued to give and support the ministry and mission of Union Church. And once again, I want to give a reminder that we are continuing to take our annual special offering, the One Great Hour of Sharing offering, which we receive throughout the Lenten season and through Easter in the Presbyterian Church USA. It's our primary mission offering in the denomination. And as with your regular offerings, feel free to mail it to us. If you're pledging to the church, you should have a pledge envelope for it. Or if you prefer, arrange for someone to meet you here. I'll be here to meet you if you need me to, or call Nishani in the office so you can bring it in person. Or remember, you can give online on our website's homepage with the link that says Give to Union Church in the section of the homepage that says Giving to Union Church. Amen. Well, let's take a few moments now and go to our God together in prayer. Hope you'll take a few breaths and pray with me. Holy, almighty God, eternal creator, redeemer, and sustainer, we give you thanks and praise this day for the gift of life and for breath in our lungs and another day to live in your grace and mercy. Alleluia. God of justice and mercy, we confess that we are both heartbroken and outraged at the continued wave of violent bigotry and ignorance directed at our Asian fellow citizens across this land. We lift to your tender mercy the grieving families and friends of those killed in hate in the Atlanta area this past week, and ask you to let your justice roll down, not just on that perpetrator, but on all perpetrators of these types of crimes. God, we condemn to hell before you these demonic manifestations of hate inflicted upon Asian persons that have increased over the past year, along with the already tragic problem of racial hatred, Lord, especially white racism and supremacy in this land directed at our black and brown neighbors. Lord, we pray that you stay the hands of those who would seek to injure or insult and transform their hearts for acceptance and civility and mutual respect. And we pray for your comfort and sustenance to be with all who have suffered from these hate crimes and racially motivated violence and hurt. We cry out to you for your Holy Spirit to flow through our land and transform individual hearts to embrace equity and goodwill and forbearance for one another. And we add these prayers to our prayers, O God of justice, that you bless the larger movements for racial justice for black and brown communities across our land as well, that we may turn from the tragedy and pain and outrage of the past caused by white supremacy and all racism and hate. Pour out your Holy Spirit, Lord, to transform systems of law enforcement and police departments at all levels in our nation, that they implement just and necessary changes in their practices to eliminate racial bias and reduce violence and transform individual hearts to embrace equity and goodwill and forbearance for others, that we may live together in peace. O healing God, our divine physician, we celebrate the vaccines for COVID-19 you've blessed us with through the gifts of science and technology, and we pray that those vaccines be justly disseminated. Healing God, we continue to pray without ceasing that you reach into our world with your almighty power. Heal from the coronavirus and COVID-19, especially those communities of color so deeply affected by it. Strengthen and comfort them, and inspire all of us to take the precautions necessary to prevent further outbreak and to bring the virus further under control. And we ask your mercy and comfort for those in grief in this pandemic over the loss of over 500,000 souls. Help, Lord. We pray indeed for our nation. O God, who cares for the orphan and the stranger, guide us in this nation to enact mercy and justice in our immigration system. To care for the overwhelming numbers of children coming to our borders, Lord, help. Reunite families. Guide and equip FEMA now to make a difference in caring for these immigrants who are now among us. And help us to carry out legitimate immigration law and policy with compassion. In the midst of the great divisions in this country, Lord, we pray you pour out your wisdom and divine guidance upon us. Grant us tolerance and understanding. Cast down the humble and the corrupt and the selfish and the greedy and the vile and the violent who would seek to divide. And we pray that in their place you raise up in human hearts across this nation the desire to strive together for the greatest opportunity, the pursuit of the greatest justice, and the practice of the most earnest goodwill for the most possible. We turn to our own congregation and its needs now, Lord. We pray, O God of compassion, to be with Carmelo DiBartolo and Michelle Nordy Hearn in the loss of Carmelo's Aunt Joni. Be especially with her husband, Tony, and carry the whole family in the midst of this loss and their grief. Continue to be with Jay Chacon and his family and the loss of his father so recently. Be with all in our midst who are grieving loss and feeling that pain, whether it's been recent or years now. Bring comfort and abiding sense of your presence, O God. And we lift to you now those in recovery from surgery and injury, those contending with chronic pain, those who may have been sick, even been positive for COVID. And we pray that you continue to bring healing, to cleanse bodies, to give strength to bodies and a sense of your accompanying presence. Lord, be with those contending with addiction and mental illness in our midst as well. Place the medical interventions and people and support groups in their lives that will bring them peace of mind and stability. And be a divine physician as only you can be to bring comfort and healing in heart and spirit and mind. We continue to pray as well, O Lord, to be a wonderful counselor for those in relationships that are struggling and hurting and broken. Send your Holy Spirit to touch those relationships where forgiveness needs to be asked, Lord, inspire it. Where it needs to be granted, Lord, inspire. Reestablish trust and healing and reconciliation, we pray, with your tender mercy, O God. We pray all these things in the powerful and wonderful, matchless name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as you go from where you are worshiping, go in the trust that Christ has drawn you and keeps drawing you into himself, to his abundant life and salvation. And walk in the light that Christ has brought in this world. Choose that no matter how daunting our mission in Christ, and the tasks that we have before us, however daunting those may feel, we have each other, all of us who've been drawn into the life of Christ together, to work together to figure out what the next steps are, what we have to lose, what needs to pass away, that we can bring new life, new mission, new vision to what we're doing here, that all may see that light and be drawn to it as well. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Creator, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.